why to do it, in another way, in other words, the motivation behind that. So this simple picture shows the role of coordinator during the event of crisis disasters. So the coordinator will get the requirements from the people who needs resources and will also get information about people who are willing to provide some resources. So I'm trying to build a system which will help this coordinator to gather this information and take appropriate actions. So I'm using Twitter data to gather this information and divide that tweets into different sets of classes. So for problem formation, I have divided the problem in three dimensions based on the techniques required to detect these three dimensions. So the first is, how can you detect the seeker and supplier behavior from the tweet? Second is, how can you detect the resource from the tweet? And third is, how can you detect the location from the tweet text? So I'll go through each of that in brief. So first is detecting seekers and suppliers. So in my previous work, I have done it using some keywords and URL analysis, but looking at the result, it wasn't quite efficient. So now we have developed some language rules based on analyzing the way people communicate during this kind of event on Twitter and implemented those rules to detect that. The second thing is, how can you detect the resources? So for that, we have a domain model. So we are applying a match on that domain model and annotating our tweets based on that domain model. And third is, this is a important thing, that how can you detect the location? So the first challenge was only the data, what I'm looking at, the Sandy data, has only 30 to 40% tweets having the location information, and that two people, as I looked at the data, the people are not directly talking there about need or supply of a resource. For example, if I am in a new
that location, need that can be tied to that location. That's what you're trying to say, right?
No, actually, how can you detect the location? So
there are three kinds of locations, right? Which of the three kinds you detect? One is already embedded as a metadata in.
Yes, so that is one what I'm not looking at, because
another is content itself.
Exactly.
Third is the profile, saying the person is from there, there's nothing else.
Yeah, so the first and third, where the location which is embedded in the data coming from Twit and the location which is in the person's profile. So the thing is,
but
we
only if you have a person's profile. So your profile says Dayton.
No,
you're talking about, you know,
I'm not looking at those two things.
Okay.
Because the thing is, most of the time we have seen that people in California or say North Carolina or somewhere, they are pointing out that here are the location where people need some help.
Mm.
And they provide this kind of information.
Mm.
So what we are doing is, we are detecting the location from the text. That tweet is containing information that at this location people require help, at this location people are providing some resources and that thing. So for that, I have used parsing techniques and annotated that location which were detected by the parser using the ontology, and that's how the location was done. So this is what it looks like, the annotated tweet. And at the end, the possible answer what a coordinator can get is, where are the people who need shelter? where is the shelter available? So this kind of answers can be easily get by the three dimensions what I talked about, the location, seeker-supplier behavior, and the resource, so that now coordinator can easily map the requirements and resources.
What would you have evaluated against? Next person, when you just come.
Yeah,
what
so
would you evaluate yourself against?
So I have a set of random tweets and I'll do it and manually evaluate it upon the results.
What are you learning in terms of techniques?
Yeah, so I have learned looking at the data, how do you determine the techniques to mine knowledge? So data-driven techniques, that is first thing what I'm learning. Another is how can you detect the location from the tweet? So that is also a separate research area what I'm looking for. And the third thing is how the knowledge base is helping in answering these questions.
Your first question was for
first was detecting seeker or supplier behavior in the tweet.
And you said the current method they use keywords or your and
no, it's current means it's what I did in last semester.
Okay.
Yes. Keywords means if I find a need or sick, that kind of keyword in a tweet, I decide that okay, it's in a need category.
And for this project,
so now we have come up with a kind of old language rule kind of thing that if the tweet is following this kind of pattern, then it's basically categorized in a neat way. So rather than looking at just a keyword, we have come up with that kind of bunch of keywords.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Okay, so my project is recovering the structure of RPF graphs with entity set. So this is a small snippet of an RPF graph, and a real RPF graph may contain thousands of tuples like that. So you can see the two entities are related, connected with two properties. So now let's say that I have a data set that I would like to use for some of the applications that I'm using, and then I go and find the data set, and now I want to use this data set for my application. So the first question comes to our mind when we want to get the relevant information from the data set is, okay, now how are we going to do it? So that is the place that some kind of a schema for a data set will be meaningful, okay? If I have the schema, that means, okay, these are the classes in the data set, these are the properties, and this is how the classes, the instances of the classes are related to each other. So then it gives me a hint to say, okay, this is a kind of a query that I might want to put into the data set and get the results. But the problem is the most real RPF data set have a very shallow schema. So you can find hundreds of examples if you go and look at the data sets in the LOD. The main problem for that is most of the data sets in LOD was created because they had some legacy data, that means the data in the traditional database format. And then they decided, okay, we want to convert it to RPF. So what they did was, okay, let's take a column, maybe the list of person's name, and say, okay, this column will be the person, and then we'll have another column for the age. Say, okay, so this is the age, so we'll have the concept person and age. They just create a connection with the property, and then they just dump the data set into the LOD without giving any idea how they use the schemas, where did they come from, and everything. And the second reason is these data sets now use multiple vocabularies. So now we have some standard vocabularies like FOF, scores, and so on. So whenever possible, they try to reuse these concepts and the properties in these existing data sets. So when going to do that, for an example, the FOF is one of the major vocabulary that people are using when they want to export the information about the persons. So this FOF vocabulary itself has like 72 properties, and once we reuse those existing properties into our data set, we cannot go to the FOF other scenario. So it would be important to specify, okay, these are the properties that I have used in my data set in this way. And the other thing is, so like I said earlier, RDF schema and OWL are the main two things that we describe to use the vocabularies. So let's say that a publisher wants to put a constraint like this. Class A can only has property P1. So this means all the instances of the class A can only have the property P. It cannot have anything else other than property P1. So the only way that we can encode this in the RDF schema and OWL vocabularies, we can say P1 RDFS domain is A. But what this means is, this would say, okay, whenever you show a property P1, the subject of this property would be something classified under A. That means it should be an instance of the class A or an instance of some subclass of an A. So that's the only thing that you can say. But this is not the constraint that I want to impose. So this is one another problem when we investigate the data sets that is out there. So in order to address that, some IBM people are coming up with something called containers. It is also in the in its very early stage. So having a proper structure. So what I did was I just prepared the motivation. That's it. So from the motivation, I'll be done. So this would helpful for people to create the queries about the RDF dataset. And data sharding, that means when we have a large data set, we need to distribute, we need to identify the different portions of the data and distribute in different machines. So in order to do that, we need to have a good idea about the structure. And also, especially when it comes to the query optimization, like in order to identify the selectivities with different graph patterns, what is the best way to do the joins between the different RDF patterns. So this will be helpful for that as well. So as the solution, I'm going to observe the patterns in the RDF data, like the type, URI patterns, outgoing properties, incoming properties, and this is the list of the characteristics that I'll be using in my algorithm.
And the data will be?
So for this one, I'm using decision data set in LOD, because it doesn't have a proper structure and so on.
Decision data set in LOD?
This is
all.
So I have done that part now. A little bit struggling with the action.
James here? Oh, yeah, he's here. Right. Oh, maybe I should have put you guys. So is everybody spending equal time?
Challenge, we try to actually convert the, we have actually
with something saying, here is the SSN ontology, and for mHealth, here is the list of things we
did.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Yeah, and here actually part of that and additional things we did, we used that SNOMED gene function data, so we actually didn't the import from that ontology, so for all of the observation, as you can see. And so then after that, we have this observation, we can actually come to the conclusion about after she actually stored data from the in the triples and passed the, say, heart rate or blood pressure and weight, we can have a conclusion based on the reasoning and say if the blood pressure is less than that and then the heart rate is less than that, all of the conclusion we can get and pass to the patient. So that's a benefit of using annotation here.
And if the information has been passed in JSON form, but it will actually be stored in our database. So we are applying actually semantics in our database. Because the open health is just referring that you should maintain the same standard for different health apps, but since we are continuing with semantic project, so we are applying semantics on database.
Minutes.
So it's just that's our
how would you know you'll be successful?
We are just like
in this challenge or at all? In this challenge.
In this project.
We are converting K-Health to this standard.
Mm-hmm.
So once the K-Health will be of this standard and we'll be able to communicate with other apps. For communicating it with other app, the K-Health, we need some other app which will be on the same standard.
Mm-hmm.
So for testing all those things, we need some other app and then we can say
so
that.
So right now, if you notice, we have not enough time, but we are working on asthma, which will have other apps possibly.
Temperature,
asthma has a lot of things. Within the, on the patient, around in your room and your house, outside, public data, social data, everything.
Yeah. No, I don't know.
So our success will be when we will be able to communicate two devices.
Mm-hmm. Have you figured out the exact test data that you will run through the system?
The data of our patient is common, actually.
Okay.
Because for the challenge, we have to send the name of the patient. So yeah, the data is the three observations we have from the
You may have to think about IRB or something like that issue about because it's private data. So you have to get a written permission from. So let's talk about it.
Because they ask us to introduce the patient.
So our project is about connecting the dots in electronic medical records. Basically what we mean by is connecting the identifying the relationship between the concepts in the electronic medical records. You might be familiar with the electronic medical records. There you have the particular status of particular visit of the patient. Doctor writes all these things about the patient history and current status and all these things. And those are unstructured, some may say semi-structured documents. Nowadays people are very interested in using the electronic medical, unstructured electronic medical records in meaningful way, and we are going towards that. And at the moment, state of the art is people are able to understand.
So you already presented this. So let's move on to
okay.
Something.
Yes. Okay. The challenge is to have this kind of sentences. Yeah, it says given her some condition and another condition, I will start her on some medication. And she is to take some medications half an hour prior to the decrease the side effects. So people are able to understand, spot the entities, but the problem is how to connect the things. As a domain expert, if I give all these concepts to domain expert, he might be able to link them. Because he knows that this is a treatment for this thing and this is a the is a treatment for side effect of this particular. So how to automate that kind of process? So the ingredient here is the domain knowledge, right? That is what domain expert would use. If I give him the, all the concepts only, then he will process that with his domain knowledge, and it will say these are the possible connection between them. So we are trying to go on that path because we have the good knowledge base. By using our knowledge base, we are trying to connect the links. Actually, we tried another way, which didn't give us a good results. I will present those the method and the results as well in my final in our final presentation. So the progress. This is about the previous method that we tried. So at the moment we have 65% of the accuracy, but we found that there is a room for improvement because the status kind of like even though you know some medication is a treatment for some disease, but in the knowledge base you may have that, but some like chronic state of that disease will not have that link. So we are trying to get that things into the by building a dictionary and all those things, and I think we can improve this 65 thing beyond that. That's the status.
Don't describe too much what you've done.
Yeah.
Tell us what you don't describe the objectives of a preliminary.
Yeah.
Tell us what you.
So I mean, I just have to tell that our plan was to provide a system like a platform where people can come and see the latest trends in health concerns.
Yes.
Because that is the main objective.
Mm-hmm.
So that they can.
So how have you set it up? What kind of data you're getting? How do you know your
Yeah, so the main the major step and we had was to find the informative asymmetry.
Yes.
We found out that Twitter is a very rich data source for us because a lot of people are
yes.
discussing. We have a collection of 1,000 tweets presently.
Okay.
And we have segregated it on different categories as diabetes and
In order to crawling the data, we use strong technology, and we have a pipeline for that also. In order that there is informative, and we are storing the database. After that, we are in progress writing a pattern actually. And once we find out the pattern, and we have to disappear from the network.
Yeah,
those things.
So, but what is your goal standard? What is your evaluation standard? You have cancer and you have diabetes, but then how do you know just how well you can identify them? Or is the ranking also important? Which because
yes, we have ranking also in our pipeline also.
Yeah.
We are finding whether the link is Google rank of the page link, whether it's shared or not, and how many times the people read it about this.
Mm-hmm.
So we are finding this all thing and storing it also.
And we have done the
Okay.
Oh, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's a disability.
change in your project, in your scope. So
I'd be actually
most interested in knowing what test case you have and how do you know you'll be successful and what is the, you know,
solid project, literally trying to build from the ground up, won't go too much over that. The why is pretty much, order this work, can we make the web a little smarter? There's people done previous work, ProBase, Know It All is a paper I was reading earlier, it's a toolkit that kind of does the same concept.
Right.
So basically, I was trying to communicate with Stanford parser tools, and they claim they have an API. It does not work very friendly in MATLAB, so I ended up writing a whole other toolkit to use low-level post and get commands from the website to actually get the information back. So an example top level is basically, that's what MATLAB will send back when I use URL gets. The bottom one shows what the Stanford online parser will get. So you can clearly see there's tags there. So you can basically parse that tag out. Taking that tag, you can then, because that was the NER, entity recognizer. Bottom one's the parser, is a part of speech tagger. So that'll tell you if it's an NNS. And they use the University of Penn tree bank, they call it, so it tells you on the left side, like NNS is a non-common plural noun, things like that. So it'll spit back a tag hash of that. I had that on there. I don't have an example of that, but it sends back a hash of what that part of speech is. So from there, I decided for a test case to only search NNSs, like nouns, so things like athletics, academics, basically physical things. And then what it does is basically the code works by going to Bing because Google's not MATLAB friendly yet. I found a way around that. Locates the first website and checks the domain. So basically, it uses the goes to the NER, tags the objects. Goes that first object, says, okay, what are you? Then goes to Bing. So in the example case, we'll take right state, Bing right state's result. Come back and say, oh, what's the first non-advertisement link? Right that edu comes up. Searches the link and says, oh, well, if it basically finds a domain at the end, like is it .edu.gov, it can usually say, okay, well, this is a government object, this is a school. So it tags this Bing's university. Then what it does, it goes into that page, and starts looking at all the links in that page. So it's kind of a modified crawler. Then also starts tagging the NESs. So it goes in the right state, looks at all the links on the right state's web page, goes through those links, and tags what is the nouns in those links. Builds a tree. So it starts building a tree structure, saying, like, okay, I found wings, athletics, academics, directories, wiki. So there's still a little bit of work to do, like, you know, wiki just comes up as a noun because in the parser it comes up as an object. Right, so there's a little work to, like, you know, what do you do with wiki? Well, do you search? Further work would be search wiki, understand what wiki actually is a resource database, maybe not accounting. So what it does, it builds this, basically a graph of all of the names it finds, and it keeps doing that over the whole thing. So I started out trying to make a knowledge database, but it kind of now is like a knowledge database slash just, it didn't mean to become a web crawler, but it kind of did. So now I'm to the point where it's like I have this tree structure of
what
just,
are you doing? So
that's the next step. I had another plan for it, and then when I sat down and actually looked at it, where it's at right now, it's not really close to that plan I had for it. So now it's like I have this object, right state, that's a university that has all these like athletics, academics, basketball, things tied to it, which is in itself an own little semantic knowledge base. But then the question is, what do I do with this beautiful little tree I have? And that's kind of where I've hit like a little bit of a roadblock. Like, what's the next step after that? Here's a little concept, and then you could basically.
So, I mean, you really have to compare, like, say, okay, what did Know It All wanted to do? What it.
What was their goal?
And yeah, and how do they get their outcome? And how do they claim that others will be able to use it? And make some case for whatever you are. Okay?
Yeah, because I hit that roadblock. And I was like, oh, but
yes.
Basically, a side note, it's a toolkit, actually. I mean, everything functionized so that you can actually use it yourself. So, that's one benefit.
To use a taxonomy for natural language understanding. But they don't have a concrete solution for that, but they are claiming that ProBase can be used on those scenarios.
Okay. Yeah, I'll check it out.
this is the event. And here's what I would like to get. Show them.
So, for our experiment, we are considering Hurricane Sandy. So, we are considering a time frame from last week of October 2012 through the first week of November 2012. And we are, for each day, we are trying to identify entities associated with this event, Hurricane Sandy. And entities could be places, people, all of these. So, in our results, we have mayors of towns who make announcements, and we have places which was hit very badly. For example, Queensboro in New York was the worst hit in Sandy for a couple of days. It was a lot in the news, people were talking about it, so that shows up higher in our results. So that's our end goal. We're trying to identify which places and which people were more important on a particular day in a given event. So that was our objective. We've talked about application scenarios before. We talk more about proposed method and architecture in our final presentation. Where we are at right now is we are done processing the Wikipedia page. We have all of the entities from the Wikipedia page. We have all the wiki statistics, the page views, the percentage increase of page views, and we have the Twitter data. We have
the data annotated for the time period you mentioned, and several different entities we identified, and how frequently they occur, and what's the percentage increase of different entities when you go from one day to another. So those data we have, and based on that data, we try to integrate Twitter data plus Wikipedia page view statistics and come up with the ranking, and we try to evaluate whatever the ranking results that we come up with versus what is published in Google Trends.
Mm.
So we did certain analysis for certain days. We have, our results align with what is there in Google Trends. But one problem we have with using Google Trends is that Google Trends does not give you day by day results. It gives the entities which was popular throughout the whole week. So
we are like roughly getting the results, but we don't have anything to exactly point out.
Can you say why would your result be better and more timely and more insightful when the fast?
Our results would be more insightful,
so
because we don't have anything.
You can just show side by side. Here is what the best we can get for Sandy, and here's what we can get, right? But here's what I would like all of you to do. So in the next class, come with one example that is that ideally demonstrates the power of your work. Preferably one that actually you got, or the one that you are sure you get in your demo, or one that is aspirational, that you you think you should be able to get. So, and this meaning it should be from the real data that you're going to use in your demonstration, final demonstration. I don't, if one is not enough for repeating it, then say, okay, here's my one day worth of data and this is what I get. But come up with a real scenario from your data that demonstrates the power of your techniques and tools and approach and so on and so forth. That's the thing. That's one thing. Second thing is always ask these three questions, and in this order, why? Why you are doing this? What is it what has to be done? And how are you doing it? But you can never get people interested in how and all those things, the trees, if you don't give the concept of the forest and the importance of the forest. Right? So I think that's what you want to be able to always do. But handwritten, and walk through the example. Try to show us that here's the data, and look, this stuff I do with it, and here's what I get. This gives me insight, this gives me better information, this gives me a better structure. Having better structure gives me this thing. That is what is very important, right? And if you think about it, today, you didn't really get that much yet. But that's how you should do always. Come start with an example. Start saying, a patient X was admitted to hospital, there is a 25% chance that he'll be back into the hospital, and that XYZ are the main reasons why he'll be back into hospital. Many of the, half of them can be found even at home, reducing his chance of getting into the hospital by another, you know, significant. Give you an example, and say, this is a randomized data of one patient. And each of you pick that up, right? Wherever possible. Some cases you may have to present a communication. All right, Michael.
Details on what we've set up. So first we made just a harvester that based on like a query of a list of words, keywords, phrases, we just got a big list, about 25,000 tweets, and that's going to be our sample data. We went through, Michael went through and handpicked out a bunch of
good examples
that he considered bullying or harassment. So we trained a classifier to, based on those he pulled out, and then we're going to use that tweet by tweet and get a score on those. You talk about the score.
So the classifier, we got 1,000 sample tweets. We went through and trained the classifier, and then we're using a naive-based classifier to score each tweet. And then, so how we have it set up now is, this is too much detail, you know, but
right.
You know, it either scores it strongly, it is a threat, or it scores it strongly, it's not a threat, or if it's in the middle, it's an unknown neutral tweet.
Yeah.
So we know.
Why is base classifier a good approach in this particular case?
We know you asked that. We're still looking into it.
Okay.
So a lot of the papers said if you're doing like for Twitter data or text in general, you want to I know there's a couple others too. There's some tree classifiers.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we're going to. So part of the remaining things we need to do, we've got the classifier working.
There are, of course, I had shared with some students about which classifier to use what. Does anybody remember? I think I had shared with the students. There was a very nice paper about how do you choose a classifier. I shared in this semester this with you guys. That is why this is students. Does anybody remember that? If you can find it, please give it to them. Ask Venmo, he may do it.
Okay. From that, we check the compatibility of the two users, because we're actually extracting when one user says something to another user. So we do a search and get a history of tweets, and we're going to check how close they are, the two users, the age differences, and stuff like that. And then also, we're going to classify their history. Recent tweets,
mm-hmm.
And see if they're loose to the classifier too.
You get one
them.
Very good example.
Well, yeah.
It's not running yet.
Yeah, we've got lots of good of the classifier. So, what we're working on now is an actual. So, because of the Twitter rate limits, we can't just run that on the whole data set.
Yeah,
so, we're going to take from the classifier the output, these are valid threats, and then for each one of those, make a web thing where you can click on a tweet, load the history, and then score based on that.
Mm-hmm.
So load it from there. But yeah, we've got lots of good examples. We've got 25,000. I've got a training data set of 1,000, and then this weekend remaining to do is to I want to get another 1,000 to test it with and get some tables of like, you know, what's the accuracy of the classifier, like a numeric accuracy, you know, look for the, you know, false positives.
see example.
Okay. Yeah.
Alan, you want to do? You're not ready, right? Oh yes. Discuss the problem, just go back, go down to
this is just the problem coming to Y part. It's just that every health grid is mandatory to encode their diagnosis information and accurate encodes. So that is the Y thing. And the first thing we need to look into is the how the ICD-10 codes are. Like if you see this, each and every concept has its own UMLS code attached to that. And also one more thing will be that it follows the inheritance principle, so that in that E08.0 satisfies all the conditions which E08 satisfies. So if you see this, you can see a tree structure kind of thing. And this is my architecture, and I'm going to explain how we are going to work on the based on this architecture. So we'll encode all the ICD-10 codes in an ontology, shown you the slide before that, all the EO8 hierarchy. We encode all this into an ontology, and we have the EMR document like that, saying that patient is suffering from so and so UMLS code. What we do is that since it's an ontology, in a class we can encode a Spark query in that, saying that if a patient has this kind of pattern in his EMR document, then he confirms your particular. So we encode that this particular query into the comment section of the class, and what we do is that we'll traverse the tree. We'll see whether all the conditions for EO8 are satisfied in the given document or not. If it is true, then we'll get all the subclasses of EO8 and then check for every subclass whether the conditions are satisfied. So this is the whole process that I'm doing. And you might have questions.
How do you know you'll be getting good results?
The basic evaluation will be manual. Like given an EMR document, we'll ask domain experts to see whether this EMR document. Yes, so that is the whole thing. And you might have questions like, in the first place, how do you go to EO8? We got to know from the domain expert that we'll be getting the chief complaint section of the EMR patient. So we index all the EO8 level and we'll directly go there, and from that we'll traverse the tree. Building the ontology and how to deal with the hierarchy thing. We are using Spark inferencing in dealing with the hierarchy in subclass.
Okay, good. How much data set you have tested on? 100? 1000?
Right now we are thinking of developing it for few diseases.
You think that your stuff will work disease by disease, or it will just open it?
At the end, it will open everything. Mm. So right now, we want to develop a prototype for only few diseases.
Because that's what you need to model,
yeah.
There. That is a good one, but there is another one that you practical exercise, you know, advise on which one to pick. That's a good one, but there's another one. Alright guys, so that's what we have. I think in the next class, I really want one example, that's it. Or something, one slide. Okay? That shows what have you achieved. Something that, and if possible, you trace through your data. if you are on schedule or ahead of schedule, it should be traced to your software as you return. If you does not, manually trace through it and say, this is what I should get. This is, if I get that as my result through my software, I think I reach the basic level of success. That's the kind of thing I mean, right? But always, in any software development, having a test case very early in, early in your work, looking at the data, now, you know, that is very important. Very important. Knowing for sure what the outcome should look like, that's very important. Alright. That's that. So, by the way, I know Michael was very, was there in the presentation discussion that Chris Reddy had. God, did you attend?
I read through the slides actually, because I don't know how the slides is. You can see more of the slides.
Okay, I think his video used a lot of data. I'm not going to see a lot of pieces. Alright, so who has neither come to Welty's talk nor looked at his video? Everybody has? Yeah? How was it? You didn't. You need to, and tell me in the next class that you have done so. So how was it? Somebody wrote a, Nishida wrote a little, you know, comment. Good.
Because I had seen the show first, long ago, and that's when I got to know about Watson and started looking into the work. And when I saw online about the same example was explained, so when I felt sad for this.
Sanjay, did you get something?
I actually watched his keynote in 2012.
Uh-huh.
It was in ISWC before going to the class. So it was more fun. For me, it was very clear. Some things were repeating, but it was still there.
Oh, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, because it was based on that.
The afternoon was what we were supposed to be discussing, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because that is for public, everybody, you know, most people have not. So that's. And if you came in the afternoon, it was very exciting to see so much conversation, so much interactions, right? So I think you guys gave a very good impression of. Alright. Huh? In fact, what he really found very refreshing is that he said all of you.